Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves, continuing medical education podcast. Join us for a lively discussion on the latest and greatest in the field of electrocardiography. We'll discuss some of the exciting and innovative work happening at Mayo Clinic and beyond with the most brilliant minds in the space and provide valuable insights that can be directly applied to your practice. Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves. In this episode, we explore the rapidly evolving field of artificial intelligence and ECG technology and its potential to transform clinical practice. Joining us is a distinguished expert in cardiology and in this field. His work in AI-augmented ECG is at the forefront of these advancements. Our discussion will cover the latest developments in AI-enhanced ECG algorithms, the major limitations and challenges in using AI in clinical settings, and what the future holds for this cutting-edge technology. Let me introduce you to our guest. Dr. Lopez is a professor of medicine at Mayo Clinic College of Medicine. He's the chair of the Division of Preventive Cardiology at Mayo Clinic and co-director of Artificial Intelligence in Cardiology in the Department of Cardiovascular Medicine. He's the editor-in-chief of Mayo Clinic Proceedings Digital Health and the co-chair of the Advanced Healthcare Analytics Workgroup, American College of Cardiology. Dr. Lopez completed his cardiovascular medicine training at Mount Sinai Medical Center in Miami, Florida, and at Brigham and Women's Hospital, Harvard Medical School. He holds a Master's of Science degree from Harvard School of Public Health and an MBA degree from Augsburg University. He has published well above 350 scientific peer-reviewed publications, and his work has been cited more than 12,000 times. What an honor. Thank you, Dr. Lopez, for joining us.
Thank you, Anthony. Thank you for the invitation, and it's really a pleasure and an honor to be here.
Well, you know, the one that's kind of leading it here at Mayo, you know, with the team, but certainly a lot of us look up to you. And, you know, I want to kind of get your thoughts on, you know, what is new in this AI ECG space? It's been so exciting. Are there any new algorithms, and where do you see this influencing, you know, clinical practice?
Well, we have been working very hard for the last 3 years to bring to light several new algorithms. We have been spending a fair amount of time testing and essentially validating the algorithm that is aimed to detect cardiac amyloidosis. Now that we have medications that are effective to treat this condition that before we really didn't have any options, I think it's really imperative to use technologies like AI ECG to identify those with cardiac amyloidosis. And the performance has been spectacular. And we have shown that in multiple cases, actually, the disease was not even suspected in echocardiograms. So very, very encouraging. Another algorithm that we have just published on is one to detect coronary disease. And we are able to detect either the presence of coronary calcification that we know is a manifestation of subclinical disease, to detect significant coronary obstructions, or patients who had very likely a silent myocardial infarction manifested by the presence of regional wall motion abnormalities by echo. But obviously, the goal here is to detect those using the ECG. Very promising, very good results. And we believe this is extremely important because, as we know, coronary disease is the main killer in the country and in the world. And if we are able to identify those with subclinical disease, I think we might be a step ahead and treat those who need it the most. And the last one I want to mention is one algorithm aimed to detect diastolic dysfunction. And we know this is a diagnosis we make with echocardiograms and in some patients with invasive studies. But in this particular case, we are able to detect diastolic dysfunction or increase left ventricular filling pressure just by the use of the ECG. The performance has been impressive. And we are actually presenting at the ACC some very encouraging results, how we can predict the incidence of heart failure just with the results of this algorithm.
You know, I think you mentioned it certainly fits in your role as not only leading the AI space, but also the preventive role of, you know, a lot of these, you know, amyloid, like you mentioned, it's more prevalent and often, you know, captured until, you know, symptoms arise and even diastolic dysfunction and coronary disease. And so it kind of fits in your role. What have you found to be kind of challenges and limitations in integrating some of this into practice? I know I use the AI dashboard a lot on all my patients, and I can see the grade and the severity, and I find it extremely helpful. But where have you found the challenges in this?
Well, there are several significant challenges, I will say. Number one is that as any new technology, we still don't know what is the perfect or ideal way to incorporate in clinical practice. Ideally, AI needs to be part of the workflow. It has to help clinicians to be more efficient, more accurate, essentially to be our aid in making better diagnosis, practicing better medicine, right? But that might not be the case all the time. For example, with the dashboard, we are very open. We essentially analyze every single electrocardiogram and provide the results, as you know. Question is that really the ideal way to deliver the results? Might be, might not be. A particular challenge is with conditions that are not very common, like amyloidosis or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And we know that no matter how good the performance is of any given test, either AI or else, the accuracy, in this case, the positive predictive value, depends a lot on the prevalence, right? So we are using electrocardiograms with AI to detect hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with no particular selection of individuals. We might end up with a lot of false positive results, even if the area under the curve or the performance is actually near perfection. So it's very interesting to see that discrepancy, a test that is almost perfect, but still you have a lot of false positive results just because you are applying this in a low risk population or a group of individuals with a low pretest probability. So that's a challenge I think we have to overcome by perhaps being more selective, applying algorithms in disease to detect disease conditions that are very rare. It's not the same for conditions that are more common, right? So, and there are many other potential limitations or challenges we will face, starting with the regulatory pathways that hopefully they become more streamlined, simpler, and still rigorous enough to be sure that whatever is approved has scientific validity that will add value to the care of patients. But certainly something we can improve. And finally, we need to get buy-in. You know, we need to convince clinicians that AI is not our enemy, that AI is our friend, that AI can actually help us be better clinicians. I think that's another potential barrier we have to overcome.
Wow. Well, I mean, three big ones, as you mentioned, prevalence in all of these makes a difference. And, you know, uniquely at Mayo Clinic, we have all these specialty clinics. So you can almost envision some use cases for specific clinics. You know, the preventive one of how you do it. And even, like you said, the FDA regulatory process, lots of hurdles, and, you know, can limit some of the integration that our patients need with some of these models. And, you know, the education, like you said, how do, you know, clinicians learn about the importance, when to use these, and, you know, when it's not correct or needs, you know, further input. And this is exciting. I know you kind of see it as challenges, but I mean, what you've done here and the integration of the dashboard has been amazing for me as a clinician. Now, how do you envision the future of this space? What are the next things that you're looking forward to?
Well, I think the future of AI ECG relies on integrating this not only in the workflow, as I mentioned before, but also incorporating this along other technologies using AI. I can see how AI ECG is just going to be one portion of different tools that we will be using in clinical practice. For example, I can see how not too far from now, we might be able to diagnose cardiac amyloidosis, not just with the ECG, but the combination of ECG and echo, and very likely NLP or, you know, complex processing of tabular data from the medical record that all together will very likely optimize the performance to levels that we are not used to levels where if the test, the combination of tests is positive or the signal is very strong, that you might be talking about perhaps almost certainty that the patient has the disease, or the opposite, that if everything is fine, almost the full reassurance that the patient does not have that disease. So I think that's going to be one key thing where the future of AI might help us to be better. I think in the future, we will also be able to do more pragmatic trials where new technology will be tested in a very efficient way. So you don't have to wait for a year or 2 or 3 years. If we do apply some techniques like federated learning or edging computer, where you can actually do a lot of testing, getting patients from many places without the traditional concerns of confidentiality and other issues, because the data might never leave the place of origin, but you can still use that to train the models and to validate the models. I think the future in AI belongs to collaboration, multidisciplinary, multi-institutional collaboration, and international collaboration as well. I think there is a huge opportunity to really scale this technology to reach all the corners of the world, even places where they don't have fancy technology. They should be able to use this because, as you know very well, you know, as you have been one of the strongest promoters of electrocardiography in the U.S. and probably in the world. Well, you know, such a simple technology that we still don't know all the potential uses we can get out of the ECG.
It's really exciting. And I think you said it in terms of how do we take this? It's collaboration, you know, with our industry partners, with other institutions, and of anyone leading it between you, Zaki, Drs. Noseworthy, Dr. Friedman. I'm excited where this field is going. And I really appreciate, you know, you adding to this. In today's discussion, we explore the exciting advancements in AI applied to ECG technology and its potential impact on clinical practice. Dr. Lopez provided us with insights into the latest AI ECG algorithms, sharing the diastolic disfunction algorithm, the coronary disease, and even the amyloid, and a number of others on our AI ECG dashboard. He talked about the challenges and limitations of integrating AI into clinical settings, and there are many of them: regulatory, use cases, looking at the prevalence and how we actually apply these in different settings, and the promise of the future of technology in medical practice. There's so much we can add and hopefully bring value to our patients. Dr. Lopez, thank you so much for sharing your expertise, your forward-thinking perspective on this emerging field. And I hope, you know, others will listen to this and just really take, you know, your advice of how to use this technology and just a hope of where this can, you know, go. Thank you so much. And I hope you'll join us again soon.
Thank you, Anthony. Thank you for the invitation. A pleasure.
Thank you for joining us today. We invite you to share your thoughts and suggestions about the podcast at cveducation.mayo.edu. Be sure to subscribe to a Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular CME podcast on your favorite platform. And tune in every other week to explore today's most pressing electrocardiography topics with your colleagues at Mayo Clinic.
This has been a Mayo Clinic podcast.